He's actually the chief pathologist with respect to poultry for the whole of Victoria. And he's here to do a presentation on current things on chooks and chook diseases. So what I'll hand him over to you, and I'll try and stop that light whistle that's going on there. What about we get rid of... that look a bit better?
Yeah, no worries.
Now you can hear that a bit. That's all right, volume wise.
Okay, no worries.
So I'm going to talk about the poultry diseases and very much to what to look for, and probably you might hear echoing very much what Grant was talking about before, about your role as the animal care. Just a little bit of background, if you wonder about my accent, I'm originally from Israel, then my veterinary science in Italy, then I work in research in Israel, I came to Australia, I was a technical and breeding manager for one of the poultry companies. And over the last few years, a few months ago, I was working for the UN system on avian influenza. The project was covering all Asia, South and Southeast Asia and Africa. I joined the DPI about 8 months ago. So what I'm going to talk about, first, how diseases might enter into your flock, your birds. What are the early identification of abnormalities in your flock? Let's go back, what is normal, what is abnormal? And I would give some example of some few common diseases that you might see in your chicks, which are quite often seen in Victoria. So how diseases can enter into your flock? There are many sort of different entry to the farm. And probably if we start, go from this point clockwise, would be sort of in order of importance. So having on farm sick birds or already dead chickens, that would be probably the main source of infection. Otherwise, people who seem to show chicken, go to show like this one, bring the chicken to the show, bring back into the own farm, that they might catch the disease on the show from other chicken and bring back, infect your other chicken. So all those movements of animals in and out of farm, to shows, to markets, the high risk situation. People can be source of infections. If they visit market, visit on Sunday, the farmer market, if they visit another farms, or the processing plant, or the egg packaging area, we might carry some diseases, virus, bacteria on the clothing, on the food crop. Contaminated the feedback, egg flakes, or even material. If you reuse egg flakes, and went to another farm, they came back, especially 501. If you use feedbacks again, are being reused farm to farm, there might be source of virus and bacteria from other farms. Litter material, we're talking about fresh litter material. If in Victoria, people use rice husks as the litter material. And cutmans are the piles and big piles out of the rice mills, and which would attract rodents and wild birds, which very likely to defecate into this. So it can be again source of infection when you bring it to your farm. Contaminated vehicles and equipment that be again to other farms. Talk about equipment that used on farm, like vaccination equipment or wooden equipment, the beacon equipment. People are sometimes people borrowing or using one farm to another. Unless it's been properly cleaned and disinfected, might be source of infection. We talk about impure feed, water or air. Feed these days, most of the feed, if it's come for feed meal, the raw material goes through testing, the feed goes through heat treatment, and pelleting, very likely to destroy any virus, bacteria, or mold in the feed. But some people are still insisting on mixing their own feed, they're buying raw material from different sources, they're not really monitoring the quality of the raw material, which can be contaminated with salmonella or other diseases. That's why feed can be very likely source of infection contamination. Also, the feed, once it's on your farm, unless it's stored in a closed area, dry storage, might get contaminated after the production. So you have to look after the feed properly. Water, again, if you use town water, it's very likely to be good quality water, but some people use surface water. So if you use surface water, might have ducks, coming on other wild birds, defecating again can be source of different diseases like influenza or Newcastle. So if you use surface water, probably you need to clone it or other method of treating the water to decontaminate. Bow water also, even it seems to be no contact of animals, can be contaminated. If sewage flow in, can be source of salmonella and E. coli. We talk about air quality. If you have farms nearby, and if you have farms in the same wind direction, can if the birds in the other farm are sick, might bring some disease into your farm. Issues of air quality, also dust or ammonia that present on your farm, might be an irritant to the air tract of the bird and predispose the birds to other respiratory diseases. When you look at the quality of their chicks, or the duckling as well, so some get into our farm, their chicks that might be already infected, might to do with the breeding stock, might be infected, and some diseases are passed from the breeders to the ovaries, to the egg, from the egg to their chicks. Disease like Plasma gallisepticum that I'm going to mention later on. Salmonella, certain types of salmonella enteritis might be transferred from the breeder to the egg to the dairy chicks. So when you go to buy dairy chicks, you have to be sure to buy from breeder that these birds are disease-free. There are some diseases that the birds might be getting infected during the hatching process, in the hatchery, cross-contamination from other eggs, other chicks that hatch at the same time. We look at wild birds might be source of a lot of diseases. Particularly we talk about the waterfowl, ducks, and the migratory one. They can carry long distance diseases. Some diseases, like even influenza that we worry the most about it, those birds might not show the clinical signs that the birds live in some sort of balance with the disease. Once they migrate after the couple of days or weeks of flying, those birds are stressed, might activate the disease. But the birds will show clinical signs, but they start to shed the virus with the fecal material. And if they contact with our chicken, which are very susceptible to influenza, our birds would come down with the disease. Talking about the pest that might present on the farm, rodents are a big source of diseases like cholera, salmonella. So rodents, we have really to deal with them all the time, make sure no rodents have no contact with our birds. Flies are a silent vector, and even different stray animals, dogs and cats, if you have foxes in this area, all of them might be carriers of different diseases. So this is, you have to, all the time, you have to look if all those vector diseases might be present on your farm and might be sort of a risk to your birds. So when we look at about what are the best options, our birds. The birds, the best way is disease prevention. This would be always the first option. And when we talk about disease prevention, we use three different methodologies that are like the biostatic effective having developing for our specific farm effective biosecure plan. Each farm is different, so you have to adopt the principle of biosecure to each different farm. The second one, to use effective vaccination program, and the third one, to use preventative medication. What often are farms using those three together in different mix? Although the implementation of biosecurity would be the most effective in the long term, also the cheapest as well. If you cannot prevent disease, then we go to the next step, that's control of disease. That's what today I'm going to talk about. Although my expertise is in biosecurity, today I'm going to talk about situation when the disease is already on your farm and how you're going to try to control it. So for effective disease control, you have to first, the most important one, is to have early detection and response. With the early detection, you want early identification of abnormalities to see what's different from the normal, and that was Grant was talking before in his presentation. You have to know what is normal, how the birds look normal, how they behave when they're healthy, how they appear, what is the color of the comb, the color of the water, what the color of the legs, what is the shape of different parts of the body, what is the form of the wings, or the shape of the legs and positioning. So if you know what is normal, then you can start to talk about, to identify what is the abnormal. So it's very important to regularly observe your birds and to know what is the normal of your birds. Once you suspect any disease, you have to get into very quick and accurate diagnosis. And sometimes you might not have the skills to go further than just identify that something is abnormal. Then the time to maybe to call your veterinarian to come to have a look, to send samples to the horse, and to further examine and confirm what the diagnosis, what is wrong. Also, once you identified exactly what is the issue there, and the laboratory might give you also a good indication what would be the best treatment to go with. For example, if you have certain bacterial diseases, some antibiotics might be response better than other, and you need the laboratory results to give you the best indication which antibiotics would be response the best way. Delaying detection and response of course would incur high cost because the issues of mortality is a loss of performance for birds, but most important would prevent good to see further spread of the disease to your neighboring farm or even on your own farm to another section of your flock or on your farm. So you need to respond as quick as possible to slow down, to stop the spread of the disease. So when we talk about the identification of the abnormalities, we have to look at two different issues: what are the clinical changes and what are the pathological changes. The issues of clinical changes, that's part that most of you as animal carers, you should be able to identify. The part of the pathological changes required far more skills of post-mortem and some of the laboratories in, and that's probably would be better to leave to veterinarians unless you've been trained and you know what to look for. When you look into the clinical changes, it's important to again to observe your birds again and again. And if you regularly observe your birds, you know what's the normal behavior and how they look, and how as healthy and how they would look as unhealthy birds. Touching the birds, listening to the noise they're making, smelling the birds, all of this using your senses will give a very clear indication when something is going wrong. So, what will be seen when clinical changes, we'll talk about general changes. The birds start to show a certain change in behavior, which will be very, you see, across the board. Most of the disease, the birds will show the same symptoms, which just indicating that the birds are unwell. And these are the first signs to look for. And the second step, they start to look for specific changes, which are typical to each individual disease. So once you see the general changes, then you start to look for the second steps for more specific changes. So what to look for? You should look for is the color of the birds, the mucosa, look the mouth and the beak of the birds, the tongue, look at the eyes of the bird, look at the color of the skin of the legs. Is it normal? It's the same color. Sometimes you see the birds are looking pale, indication for certain anemia that might be caused by certain diseases. If it's very dark red, indication dehydration, birds that haven't drank water for the last 2-3 days. Also indication of high temperature, fever. You look in this size, the different components of the birds, different parts of the birds, see is it normal, bigger than normal, or smaller than normal. Look, for example, if you sinuses, you look at the sinuses of the bird, the face, if it's a large, you know, some process of inflammation of the sinuses, the upper respiratory system is going on, it's a good indication. Checking your birds for the bear, check for body weight. But you check the breast muscle. Bears which are wasted, you feel immediately that no breast muscle. You feel the keel, the bone is very, very sharp. This is an indication of bears that haven't eaten much, or some certain diseases like Marek, which is a tumor disease, the bears would be wasted and you feel very sharp keel, very light bears. Again, for shape of different parts of the body, in position, the position of the different part. If it's in the non-positioning or irregular, for example, if you see drooping wings or legs which are twisted, the situation of certain paralysis. Again, indication of certain diseases. You feel that once you pick the bird, you can also sense the temperature of the birds. You can sense if the birds are picking certain parts, if you feel like the joints are very hot, indication of inflammation of the joints. looking for stoning, excessive stoning of the vent, quite a few indication of diarrhea, can be to do with enteric disease, with intestinal disease, but in birds, because the urine and the feces come from the same cloaca, from the same opening, might be also issues with kidneys. If the kidneys are malfunctioning, also you'll find very loose dropping, and the vent would be dirty. You look for discharges that might be coming from the eyes, from the nose, from the ears, etc., from the part of the body. You check for the consistency, for the color, if it's yellow or transparent, look for smells, all these kind of issues, all this evaluation can give you if something is wrong or not. And also, if, when you talk on the phone with your vet, if you can't capable to describe the system, all this variation from normal, you'll help the vet to form some sort of early diagnosis. Looking for lesions, again, because like in the mouth, or in the eyes, or on the skin, for example, we have in the feed, during this time of the year, might have toxins, certain toxins which are generated on the feed, which cause quite an erosion in the birds, in the mouth, and on the tongue. So it can give you some indication that something is growing. Yes. So, as I mentioned before, there are certain general clinical signs that are indication of general disease of the birds. And the general indication you see across the board in many diseases, you see birds that don't move much, they're depressed, they're lethargic, don't respond much to any changes, they're very quiet, see still, that's very typical of those birds, with the head very close to the chest. You find the birds usually stop drinking, that's the first step, and to this day they also stop eating. Ruffled feather, and again those birds, if you see the feather, the truffle, and then the next step again, you start to see dropping production, that slows, reduced production of eggs, so they stop altogether, they don't put weight, it's about boilers, and then start to see increased mortality. So all the indication of general disease that they run into the flock. When we're dealing with some more specific area, looking for respiratory disease, for example, normally you must hear the birds are walking to the shed, the birds are sneezing, gasping, coughing, eyes and nasal discharge, swelling of the face, you the sinuses, of bluish color, like these birds, or the cob and the bottles, all changes related to the respiratory abnormalities. And the bluish color usually is to do with birds, which the air exchange is reduced, they don't get enough oxygen, so they start to get this sort of bluish color. And again, these birds which are detected, inhale this respiration, and find that it's an extended neck and gasping for air. Birds with enteric abnormalities, they find very watery dropping. And you might find it sort of brownish, yellowish color, foamy. That's usually more caused by parasites. But sometimes you might find diarrhea or sort of very greenish color. This indication is of bird that stopped eating, it is the bile that can be swarmed. Green diarrhea is very typical of the disease that we worry the most about, the most about every influenza in Newcastle. You find sort of greenish diarrhea. What is very typical, we find a very dirty vent. The rewriting. And on the floor, you find also stains of diarrhea. It's a little bit difficult to see the picture. When we talk about neural abnormalities, we might see a certain paralysis like these two birds. It might be two legs stretched to the back, or maybe one leg, one to the front, one to the back, certain paralysis. And those are paralysis you find in diseases like Marek, but also again in Newcastle and influenza, you will find this sort of paralysis. You might find birds with twisted necks or what you call stargazing positions, all indications of certain damage to the neural system of those birds. We're also looking for different skin abnormalities, looking for. For example, vegetables and birds, and this is typical, the one on the left, typical pox, fall pox, disease that virus can be transmitted by mosquitoes. You might find different nodules and ulcers, extensive subcutaneous hemorrhages, that again
can be done, can relate it to Newcastle or influenza. And scaly legs, we can talk about later on, the mites and lice might cause those of alterations. So, speaking in general terms, I might give you a few examples of two different viral diseases, two bacterial diseases, two parasitic diseases, and one fungal diseases, just sort of as an example. And diseases that we see quite often in Victoria. So we're talking about infection or arthritis or ILT, as we seem to refer to most often. The last probably 2-3 years is the most important disease, or the disease causing the most economical damage to the poultry industry in Victoria. And this is a disease that is caused by virus, by herpes that spread from birds to birds through secretion from the nose and the respiratory tract. In the very mild form, you might find those birds you see, like swollen in the head, in some sense, this swollen in the eyelid, bit discharge from the eyes and from the nose. And you start to see the birds are producing less eggs, dropping egg production, and the birds are not gaining body weight the way you would expect, talking about broilers. While in the severe form, you start to see birds are coughing very loudly, and the problem is the spit blood. And this is a very typical what you would see in farm that suffer the severe form. See, birds spitting blood, and birds are seeing very extended neck and gasping for air. The mortality can reach from 10 to 20% and even higher in some cases. If you're going to see the vet performing postmortem with these birds, the most obvious is the air pipe or the trachea. It's covered with blood, hemorrhages in the trachea. And in certain cases, also you might find some pus as well present in the trachea. The ALT is what we call the fiber disease. If you're suspecting ALT in your farm, you're supposed to call your vet and you're supposed to notify the PI. The reason, because the disease clinically appears very similar to exotic diseases like Newcastle and to even influenza. And those diseases we have to really be on top of this. If we have outbreaks, we really have to control it very carefully. So ALT being look very similar, once you suspect, we have to check, to exclude, to make sure we don't deal with influenza or Newcastle. Once you have ALT on your farm, you should notify your neighbor because it's a highly infectious disease. You don't want to spread disease to your neighbor. In case you give them a chance to upgrade their own biosecurity, their own procedures to protect their own birds. And I'm sure nobody wants to be blamed to spread disease to his neighbor. For prevention, we look to improve biosecurity, including cleaning and disinfection of the farm after the end of the production cycle, and effective vaccination program. What I would like maybe to tell some story about the vaccination program, because that's in a way the part of the story why we have so many outbreaks the last 3 years. In Australia we used to have this ALT virus. It's subdivided under different types. There's some classification. So traditionally we had in Australia type 1. It was present in Australia, and the vaccine that was available in Australia was type 1. Origin was isolated in South Australia. The vaccine was produced here, originally by Webster, later on by Fort Dodge, and once Fort Dodge had been taken over by Pfizer, they decided Australia was too small for them to manufacture the vaccine in Australia. They decided to manufacture the vaccine in the US and bring it to Australia. Every so often. We got into this situation a couple of years back that Pfizer were not capable to produce enough vaccine and was short of vaccine in the country. As a result, the poultry industry started to ask them to bring to the country another type of vaccine. So Intervet decided to bring, they applied and they got the permission to bring another type of vaccine from Holland of type 6. So now we're getting from Australia two vaccines, type 1, which is Australian region, and the type 6 originally from Holland. We start to vaccinate flocks, particularly in layers, to give the two vaccines on the same site. The two different vaccines. And what happened is two vaccines can start to interact with one another, start to exchange genetic material, and they generated a completely new virus, type 8 and later on type 9, which are very, very aggressive. So that's what we're having now. We have type 9 is dominating the field in Victoria, and the current, even vaccine bears are not responding as well to this type 9. So that's quite an interesting story. But still, if you vaccinate properly, and you're more likely to reduce the chance of having an outbreak.
What about your neighbours, though? If you've got neighbours who are using the other at different times, that's how that problem.
The Papa, yes, because this virus is spread by air.
Yeah, so you could still be at risk to get type 9.
Yeah, but and by now type 9 is predominant around the peninsula, with high concentration poultry farm, around the Geelong area, with another high concentration poultry farm. So it seems like type 9 this year, nearly every case that we had, even north of Bendigo isolation from backyard farm, came as type 9 as well. So it seems like it's really crossed the state, type 9 dominating the state at the moment, and that's why we have the difficulties to really to protect our birds with the current vaccines that we have. So there are a lot of talks about importing different vaccine that cannot mutate, cannot vector vaccine, but genetically engineered vaccine that are behave differently than the traditional vaccine. Another virus that I would like to talk about is avian influenza, and that is sort of my subject. I was working on this disease for a couple of years. But also, if I don't know if you're aware, we had influenza on duck farm in New Gisborne and Mitten only last year ago. And recently, about 2 months ago, outbreak of hypogenic influenza in Maitland in the Hunter Valley, New South Wales, in Fire and Chicken. So, although the outbreaks are not that frequent, but if we're looking at the 2012, we had probably about 6 or 7 outbreaks, more than many what we had in the previous years. So we wonder if this sort of the trend might see more and more outbreaks of influenza. So it's still under the classification of exotic diseases, meaning diseases come from overseas, it's not diseases present, but it's not that 100% correct, because it's caused by influenza A virus, and then it goes to different classification. What we talk about LPI or HPI. The LPI stands for low pathogenic avian influenza, and the HPI stands for highly pathogenic avian influenza. So the outbreak that we had in Victoria, the ducks, was LPI. The outbreaks in New South Wales was HPI. Again, under that, under molecular categorization, you go to subtyping, then the subtype by age and by 5, or by N, and ends out. We know that in nature about 15 types, different types of age, and 9 types of N, and they can appear in different combinations. The H5N1 is this particular subtype that appeared in China back in 1996, since then spread all around the South and South Asia, to Europe and Egypt, and became very predominant virus. The risk of this particular virus being very aggressive, killed chicken very, very quickly, but also was capable to infect human and cause mortalities. Up to now, we had maybe only 600 people died of the disease, but more than 60% of the people that got infected died of the disease, so it's a very aggressive virus. And all the time, the scientific community very worried this particular virus might mutate and become human pandemic. So the source of infection for influenza usually contact with wild birds, particularly ducks, because as I mentioned before, ducks might be silent carriers, not showing clinical signs, but once they're in contact with chicken, they can transfer the disease to become clinical and very, very aggressive. If you have infected poultry or contaminated equipment, losing vehicles can be source of infection for people that have been on another farm, or in Asia situation, live birds market can bring the disease into the farm. The clinical and pathological signs are sudden mortality, which can reach up to 100%, and we see very high mortality in highly pathogenic avian influenza. We see respiratory signs, sneezing, gasping, coughing, eye and nasal discharges, swelling of the face, and bluish cough, again because the birds have difficulty to have proper oxygen exchange. You see bleeding from the mouth, the nostrils, green diarrhea, as I mentioned before, hemorrhage under the skin, particularly the shank and the footbed, and neural signs, paralysis of the legs and the wings and the foot and neck. I'll show a few photos. And this, the photos are very much of the H5N1, the very aggressive virus that seems to circulate in our neighbor in the north, in Indonesia, very, very commonly. So when you walk into a farm that outbreaks, you see basically a carpet of dead birds. The morning, thousands of birds are dead. You look, you can see swollen faces, the synapses are very enlarged, and you see blue cones and waters, and this is sort of normal against bluish one. The same here, normal against bluish one. You find the subcutaneous hemorrhage under the skin, hemorrhage of the thickened mesion, the shanks and the footbeds, and the neural signs, the paralysis and the twisted neck. And that's when the disease a bit go for a couple of days. Some birds will die immediately, some birds become more chronic, take a few days, and then you start to see more and more neural signs. Again, every influenza is identifiable. This one is to take the mask called your vet, and they have to come and take examples because we need to make again differential diagnosis from Newcastle, and the lab would give us the results if it's influenza or not. Once the birds are identified as positive, those birds must be culled and disposed safely. The farm has to be clean, disinfected, and a lot of surveillance will be going around the farm to make sure that the disease doesn't spread to other farms. And I don't know if you've seen, this is a very common picture you see in Asia. People come to farms all with protective gear, with coveralls and goggles and masks, and culling thousands of birds. And that was, in a way, a similar picture what we had recently in New South Wales. Destruction of 50,000 birds over a couple of days. For prevention, the best way is obviously improved by security and avoid contact with wild birds. Treatment is not available. There are some vaccines that are used overseas, but in Australia we're not allowed to use any vaccine. They're not available, we're not allowed to use vaccine. And that is very much for trade reason. We have the ability to eliminate the disease as quick as possible, and so to minimize the disruption for trade. Because once we have influenza in Australia, we have to report to the World Health Organization, the OIE, and the province. We can't export not one single chicken or eggs or any product. So we try to eliminate the disease as quick as possible to declare freedom, and then we can resume trade. If we start to vaccinate, this process will be much more prolonged, and the industry will suffer almost severely. So culling, disposal, and clean would be the best option without vaccination. So how do people get infected with influenza? And that's very common. We see it more and more in Asia. And probably in the cases that come being reported, they are not the tip of the iceberg. Because, for example, I was working in Vietnam, or in Indonesia, we used to hear a lot about human cases, the people that died in the provinces and never been reported to the central system, so they never went into the registration of cases. So people are getting infected through the mouth, nose, or the eyes, or lungs. The risky activities are touching infected poultry on farm or at home, contact with fish's blood and fluid during slaughter. People, particularly in this situation we see in Vietnam, but in many other Asian countries, live birds market, people always don't buy chicken which already been processed and cleaned. People buy birds, all that's slaughtered in the slaughter markets, for birds, live birds, they take home, keep for a couple of days, and then they slaughter themselves and dress the birds. But all those activities in the market and at home, handling all those birds, if they are infected, are very high risk for human infection. Also, people that eat raw or undercooked poultry meat or even eggs, although eggs are less likely to be source of infection, just stuff. So what does it look like? It's looking, initially it might look like seasonal flu, with the usual high fever, coughing, dry throat, but Chukchuk disease is far more severe. People quickly deteriorate very quickly into kidney failure, and the mortality, as I mentioned, is very high. More than 60% of people that got infected with H5N1 died of the disease. So this is extremely aggressive virus. And now let's talk about the viruses, about two different bacterial diseases. And fall cholera or aspergillosis is one of those diseases caused by bacteria, Aspergillus mucosida, and the source is usually through expression from the mouth, nose, eyes of diseased birds. But rodents, rats can be a good source of infection if you fecal material is defecating into the feeders of the bird, can be source also. Other animals might be source of infection. Can be also even dogs or foxes might be carrying the bacteria in the saliva in the mouth. And if they get access to your birds and they bite the birds, you might transmit the disease as well. So in the mild chronic form, you might see only localized infection, like these particular birds might see pus in the abscess in the bottle or in the joints, shade in the foot. But this is the chronic, much milder form of the disease. In the more aggressive, in the acute form, you might see sudden death, depression, birds stop drinking, eating, after just sort of the general symptoms of birds which are unwell. But then you start to see also diarrhea, increased respiratory rate, and when it's performed post-mortem, you find the pneumonia and consolidation of the lungs. We talk about marbleization, it looks like marble. It's very, very solid and has this sort of design, like marble. You look at the liver is very much enlarged, and you find white spot of the tissues, but white spot of necrosis in the liver.
Are there any signs with the diarrhea? Are there specific?
The diarrhea is yellowish color.
Okay, yeah.
For prevention, you need biosecurity, and which would include very strict rodent control and vaccination. And if you see putting autogenous, when you talk about autogenous vaccine, the fall cholera, this bacteria, the Aspergillus, there are many subgroups, subtypes. It might be typical to different farms in different area. So if you have repetitive cases of cholera on your farm, the best way to take some samples to send to a laboratory, they can isolate the specific type, and then they produce a vaccine that's specific for this particularly isolated present on your farm. It would get the best protection. It would call autogenous vaccine that is locally for your own, specific for your own farm. It would give you the best protection. As far as treatment, you can use antibiotics or safer drugs. What is important if you medicate birds which are in lay or near, have to be killed soon, you have to maintain, to keep the withdrawal period. You can't use eggs which are for birds that which are treated with sulfur drugs or antibiotics. Another bacterial disease that affects our birds quite commonly is mycoplasmosis. In the past, people used to refer to it as CRD, chronic respiratory disease. CRD was sort of, people have been using it very commonly a few years back, think this of terminology and then disappear over the year. It's caused by a specific mycoplasma called Mycoplasma gallisepticum, and if you're really in the jargon in the industry, everybody talks about MG. So the source of infection would be secretion from the mouth and the nose, the eyes of diseased birds, but also the possibility of vertical transmission. If you talk about the vertical transmission, the breeders are infected, the bacteria move into the ovaries, and when they lay the egg, the bacteria are already in the egg, the chick is hatched, the hatchery is already infected, come to the farm, and in a few days we start to show clinical signs. So the disease moves all the way from the breeder to the dairy chicks. And you see it once near the farm. The clinical sign appear usually not immediately, sort of mycoplasma, it's a chronic or slow evolving disease. Might see the first signs in the birds between 5 to 12 weeks of age, with some coughing, sneezing, running nose. And the birds might be standing on their own, very quiet. one bears a great production, you will see reduction in egg production, the susceptibility, if you start talking about breeders, they're not hatching as well as healthy birds, weight loss, standard growth, breeder, boilers, increased feed conversion, it means they're not very efficient in utilizing the feed. You see the rubbing and scratching the eyelid, and the signs of seizure are very large, very swollen. And when you perform the smoking, the air sacs, you find air sac lichens, but you find some foam material on top of the air sacs as well. The main issue with mycoplasma, it's predisposed those birds to other respiratory diseases, because once they suffer chronically, it might not be so obvious that they are sick, but once those birds come across virus like infection, bronchitis, or Newcastle, or influenza, or any other respiratory disease, the disease would appear far more severe, and the loss would be much higher in terms of mortality and loss of production. So it's very much predisposing the birds to other diseases. In terms of prevention, we talk about good biosecurity, LOS, purchasing their chicks from the breeders which are known to be mycoplasma-free, and use of vaccination in breeders and layers. And that's something probably so worthwhile mentioning. This particular vaccine, the TS11, it's what you call a live vaccine that had been developed in Australia. It was the very first vaccine, live vaccine for mycoplasma, developed by Melbourne University. It's a genetically engineered vaccine. It's probably the best, the export that have been commercialized by Bioproperties, and exporting all over the world, and probably till today is the best vaccine available for mycoplasma. So that can be sort of keep as a local industry success story. Birds which are infected can be treated with antibiotics, and tyrosine is the antibiotic of choice, but you have to keep in mind that antibiotics won't eliminate the disease, it just will keep it sort of quiet for a while. And once the bear is stressed again, it's going to flare again. So you might see sort of cycles of the bears coming, looking clinically unwell. You medicate them, everything will be okay for a couple of weeks or months, and then reappear again. Because once the bears are infected, it's impossible to eliminate it. But yeah, you just have to keep it under control. The coccidiosis now, I'm moving from bacterial disease to parasites, and the first one I'll talk about coccidiosis, which is a type of monocell parasites, or as we call them, protozoan parasites. It's parasites of only single cell, and it would appear under the name of coccidia or emeria, they're the same, just different names. The disease itself, it's caused by the replication of this parasite in the lining cells of the intestines. Once they replicate, then they break the cells and move into the intestinal intestine, then to move to new cells. So once the damaging, the rupture of the cells that would cause the disease itself. The source of the infection is ingestion of the oocyst. Oocyst, in a way, this is the oocyst here, it's like the egg of the parasite. Once the bears are infected, they produce these oocysts, the eggs, which are eliminated by the fishes, can be survived for a very long period of time in the environment under high temperature, dryness, even certain chemicals can survive quite long. So if you finish the production cycle, you didn't clean the disinfect properly, and some of those oocysts left behind, you're placing new flocks that don't have any protection. Once they're walking in, they ingest. Of this oocyst that come down disease and very quickly see disease appear, replicate appear in your flock. Different species of animals, they have their own specific coccidia or specific emeria. In chicken we have this 8-1 that's specific for chicken, and the group on the left that the one that would cause more severe disease. The emeria, the Ternella necatrix, the cervulina maxima cause more severe disease. The one on the right hand, much milder form of the disease. And you can see each one of them affect different segments of the intestine. So if you're looking for example, the cervulina would affect very much the upper part of the intestine, as opposed to the upper part of the intestine, while the brunetti would affect the lower part of the intestine. This is the proventriculum, and this is the anus. So the bulletin very low part of the spine. The neck is again the upper and middle part, the maxima, the middle part of the spine, the neck plex, the middle part of the spine, the plecox, the upper part, and the tenilla, only the cica. So each one has their own specific area that they enjoy attacking. So the clinical sign, which is very linked to different types of area of coccidia, but in general term, you've seen birds suffer depression, loss of condition, some paleness, especially you can see it on the shank of the birds, sort of very pale, the wing groups and ruffle feather. And of course, you start to see diarrhea, white is swelling around the vet, and blood dropping in some certain cases, like in male neck attacks, you can see more blood because of the hemorrhage in the intestine as well. The typical the lesions are very typical to each one of those area, but also damaging the lining cells of the intestine. So the tenilla would cause severe hemorrhages, including blood in the cica. If you look at the cerebral lining, probably difficult to see, but they're causing what they call necrosis, damage to the lesion on the intestine, which appear very much like leather. You can see like line, like white lines in the intestine, like very much like leather-like. And the maxima doesn't cause much damage, but we find orangey content in the intestine. As consequences of this infection, we see severe damage to the lining of the intestinal cells, we see after that could affect the performance of those birds, we see gross retardation, poor conversion rate, uneven flux, poor performances in egg production and quality of meat in boilers, and mortality in severe cases if they are not treated. And again, does coccidiosis predispose the birds to other secondary infection by bacteria that could cause further infection to those birds?
Would you expect it in mature birds or just young birds?
Usually you see it in younger birds because once the birds have been exposed, and most birds have been exposed, they develop immunity. So usually we see it probably between two and a half weeks and 4 weeks, this is the age range we see in boilers very commonly. In terms of prevention, effective cleaning and disinfection would remove any oxygen that present in the environment. You know, not avoid overcrowding, because once you have overcrowding, the birds start to shed and the others start to move to other birds and replicate more. More application, you know, more the contamination of the environment is higher and more likely other birds to get infected. So try to reduce overcrowding, medicated feed anticoccidial. And that is used very commonly by most feed mills. They're adding specific anticoccidials that integrated into the feed, so to prevent any outbreaks. And use of vaccination, which is a new technique. I don't see in Australia, nobody use it here yet. Not in boilers, people use it for breeders, but overseas it's very common practice of vaccinating layers, breeders, and boilers. And it seems to work very, very well.
Backyard people, purebred breeders can get it, because Graham Richards has recommended it for some people too.
Yes, Graham Richards, of course, because his wife was involved in the development of the local.
Yeah, I mean, that's a handy one. They should know, because they're the local ones who are working.
But again, overseas people are vaccinated across the board, for also for boilers, not only breeders and layers, so everybody is vaccinated. It seems to work very, very well. Treatment are sulfur drugs and other anticoccidial drugs, and early treatment is essential if you want to reduce losses, which is very obvious. Another parasite, or ectoparasites, are lice and mice. We see more and more because they have small flocks. Also, but in breeders, you see long-lived birds. They feed on the lice, seems to feed on dry skin, feathers, while mice to feed on blood coming, particularly at night time, on the birds, suck the blood. During the day, they get all the birds and hide in different places in the shade. This sort of infestation usually affects the birds. It can be wild birds, if they have access to their bird, might be the source of the infestation. But contamination of the environment, if they don't clean properly between one flock to another, because lice and mice, they hide in cages, in the sheds, in the crevices, and one of the birds get in the sheds and come out and stuff. infected. In the clinical side, we see damaged feathers, scaly legs, and you can see in these birds here. Okay. And then the secondary, as the birds are highly irritated, don't drink and eat properly, you see broken egg production and in body weight. This is secondary to the just to the irritation of the birds with each other, won't feed them properly. In terms of prevention, effective cleaning is infection between flocks, reduce people traffic that might be source of the disease, elimination of wild bird, which is always a good idea. And chemical control by regular dusting or spraying. You have to do it every 2 weeks because that's over the lifespan of the chemicals. You spray the walls, the walls, the floor, the cages, the boxes, empty boxes. And in certain cases, you can also just dust the birds as well. Although this probably would be overkill and might be due to some sort of intoxication, it's better probably to spray it. Feed the environment of the birds and the birds themselves. And to use insecticides of relatively low toxicity, like pyrethrin or malathion-based product.
I didn't think ivermectin was whether it was off limits or what's the term, it's not recommended.
Okay, you have to use off. Yeah, you use off.
So you can't recommend
off.
It?
The vet can do it because it's off label, you can't label to use it.
Yeah.
But this we use ivermectin for treatment, not as preventative. Once we have birds, we saw the scaling leg, then we use it as for treatment, not for preventative.
So can you clear up with people what form? Because no one ever seems to know the form of ivermectin. Is it oral? Is it poron? What?
You can use it as a poron, you use it. Yeah. But that's what you would have the vet to prescribe you exactly how to use it because it's off label.
Is it diluted or is it a weaker strength?
No, you've opened Pandora's box here, actually.
That's why you get different products on the market under the name. You have to go to the vet to get this.
Well, I've got
the prescription, he will give you exactly.
I've got three bottles here, so there's somebody that does.
So that's probably already done.
There's product. Someone on this ground that sells it, they don't have it labelled, they don't have poisons, no one knows, right?
So that's here every year.
Yes.
That is in a way illegal.
It's illegal, that's why I'm prompting you to go where you are, because I know. So what do you do, you see? And there's nothing
and
there.
And you don't know what is the concentration.
No, you don't know anything about it.
That's part of the risk you do, because if you don't use it, then you don't know what it is. If you use it already or concentrate, you might kill your animals that you use.
Yeah, you can take the risk. But if you're suffering, yeah, you want to give it a go. Here's what it is, and it hasn't harmed anything. It's got rid of scales and worms.
So instead of going to the vet, you've got an empirical system to try.
Going to the vet.
It works, I don't work.
I can't recommend going buying it in a legal way.
You can't recommend it.
Yeah.
No, you can't.
Okay. the actual vaccine for mycoplasma before, you didn't mention the name.
DS11.
DS11.
Yep.
And that's through your vet or through...
Yes, we are.
Not through the
yes. But you know, it depends on how many birds you have, because probably one vial would be good for a couple of hundreds, maybe a thousand. So maybe if you have only a few birds, it might be worse if you have some other neighbors to buy together.
Do they have to be vaccinated at the same time?
Yes, all the birds have to be vaccinated at the same time. And usually, if you cut early age, you vaccinate by eye drop. And what is important, those birds, because the vaccine has to survive to be effective for the life of the birds, in the birds, in the upper respiratory system. So, to me, that you can't or limited using other antibiotics for other reasons. But if you don't use antibiotics for other reasons, you might kill the vaccine, and then you have to revaccinate again.
And does it work? Is it better to do it on young stock or
young
and old? So you've got some young chicks and you've never used this vaccine before and you have older birds. Can you go ahead and do the lot?
You can do the lot, yeah. But then if you can do it from the young birds or you can keep them separate from the older birds to develop the protection, then after joining the other one, because maybe the older one might be already infected.
saying you want to protect, to build, let it build protection before you join the rest of the guys. But the principle of this particular vaccine, it's operate on, it was genetically engineered that this particular bacteria of the vaccine can live only under temperature of 39 degrees. The body temperature of chicken is 42 degrees. It means that this bacteria, this vaccine strain, can survive very well in the upper respiratory system and block any other bacteria from entering. But at the same time, it can get into the body and cause any disease. So it has to be able to protect the birds, have to survive in the upper respiratory system for the rest of the life of the birds. And any other type of antibiotics might kill it. So you have to be very careful what antibiotics you use for other reasons. If you use antibiotics, then you have to revaccinate your birds.
And so it's good on a drop,
you said? It's yeah. What's that?
Oh, I knew you were in trouble when I saw it.
It can be used for treatment. And the last thing I want to talk about is macrotoxins, which are very relevant for this time of the year. The macrotoxins are different toxins which are produced already in the field on top of cereals, the wheat, on the maize, in the field. And under condition of high temperature and high humidity, the combination, then when this mold, the fungus start to replicate and to produce this chemical, the macrotoxin. The important, there are quite a few of them, but the important one for poultry, they are particularly these three, the aflatoxin, the ochratoxin, and the p2-toxin. That is three that are important for poultry. There are few additional ones, and they're important not only for poultry, for other animals as well. So the aflatoxin, birds are ingested in the feed is contaminated, you start to see immediate decrease in feed efficiency, increase in the susceptibility of fungus to oozing, production in egg production. But the most important one, the birds suffer immune suppression. So in those birds, if you try to vaccinate them, they're not going to respond to the vaccine properly. Or if they've been exposed to quite banal germs that circulate around, that usually the birds are capable to deal with, to protect them, they would calm down the disease. So the immunosuppressive effect of aflatoxin is the most critical one. And once the expression is very heavy, you might see also direct mortality as well. The T2-toxin causes very typical vision in the mouse, in the tongue. Very difficult to see, but what we call erosion, if you feed to young chicks, particularly young ducklings, they are particularly susceptible. You see on the tongue, you see erosion like white marks on the tongue and around the mouse. You see additional poor feathering, reduction in growth, increased feed conversion rate, reduction in production, egg production, and not putting weight properly, and again, immunosuppression and mortality. So, this is a quite common line between different macrotoxins. The ochratoxin would cause weakness, anemia, decrease in feed consumption, decrease egg production, production, growth rate, again, immunosuppression. So you can see, a lot, the symptoms are quite similar, and the immune depression is very consistent in all these macrotoxins, and would affect the birds in terms of ability to respond to vaccine, or to respond to different challenges by different virus bacteria in the field. So those are different diseases, just as an example of what you might see on your farm. And just in terms of prevention, you want to call it your form of tail if you're mixing your own feed. And that's quite very difficult if you buy mixing small quantities. The large feed mills, any batch of grain that come into the country or come to the mill, they send to the laboratory for testing for market toxins. You want to ensure the cool and dry storage, you don't want mold to fungus to develop on the feed, and you can use anti-macrotoxin. Talk about the macrotoxin binders, different chemicals which are added into the feed, which might absorb the macrotoxins, or sometimes have the ability to neutralize the different product based on clay, or which are the most common one, but they are sort of absorbing and neutralizing macrotoxins. In terms of treatment, use anti-macrotoxin feed, and that's probably Once you have the symptoms, it's a bit difficult when you have those deaths. It's much better to prevent when from happening. So that's just a summary. Maybe the disease might enter the farms, numerous roots, early identification of abnormality in your flow, combined with early response, reduce losses and minimize the possibility of spread disease to other flocks, to neighbors, and there are many diseases affecting our birds. A few of them, and that's why you have to be really be on the guard to make sure that your birds are healthy. If something happening, you need to